I'm a dermatology trainee in Brighton, and I'm going to talk about deep fungal infections. So compared with the superficial infections that Sidra has already spoken about, these infections are not as common. But I thought we'd kind of go through these questions. So firstly, what are deep fungal infections? How do they present and how are they diagnosed? How are they treated? And then finish by looking at what's the impact or the association with flooding and these infections. So to begin with, deep fungal infections are subcutaneous infections. They're also referred to as implantation mycoses, and that's because they're caused by direct implantation or inoculation of the organism through the skin and into the subcutaneous tissue by some kind of trauma. So for that reason, they usually occur on exposed body sites, and they're caused by organisms that exist in the environment, and usually they occur in young immunocompetent individuals, so typically young males that work in agriculture in rural tropical countries. The typical presentation is a chronic, slowly progressive course, but there can be disabling consequences. So looking at the presentation, we'll just focus on the three main deep fungal infections, which are mycetoma, sporotrichosis, and chromoblastomycosis. So mycetoma, firstly, this is a condition that's characterized by subcutaneous swelling or mass, which is usually painless, the formation of sinus tracts, and then you get a discharge from these sinus tracts, which contains grains, so just like grains of rice, but smaller. And usually the foot is the most common site of infection, but it can affect anywhere on the body. This is a mycetoma lesion that's been excised from the ankle. And when you cut into the mass, you can see these dark black grains in the tissue. And that's the characteristic feature of mycetoma, the presence of these grains or microcolonies of the organism. There are two main forms of mycetoma. There's a fungal form, which is eumycetoma, and a bacterial form, which is actinomycetoma. And the color of the grains can guide you towards the causative organism. So whether they're dark brown to black or whether they're white to yellow grains can be a helpful clue. And depending on what part of the world you're in, the causative organism varies. So in Africa here, Madurella mycetomatis, which causes dark grains, is very common. Whereas in Mexico and Brazil, the bacterial form of mycetoma is much more common, and caused by usually by Nicardia. So these are some pictures of mycetoma. So you've got the subcutaneous swelling here, you've got sinus tracts with purulent discharge, and then just here you can see a small white grain just coming out of the sinus tract there. Another mycetoma of the lower leg, again you can see subcutaneous swelling and nodules with sinus tracts. Similar clinical features here on the shoulder. And another larger mycetoma on the abdomen, but again with all the same clinical features. In terms of collecting your sample, you can often express pus or grains out through the sinus tracts and collect them directly, or you can also aspirate from the mass. And if you do a direct microscopy of that material, this is what you might see. So these are small grains of Nicardia and lots of white blood cells. With mycetoma, the infection can invade deeper into bone, and so imaging is important if it's available. This can be with an X-ray showing cavitating lesions here, and if you've got MRI available, that can be quite helpful, and it shows up these little white rings, these ring structures. Okay, so sporotrichosis now. This is caused by species of sporothrix. These are the main pathogenic species here, Schenckii, Brasiliensis, and Globosa, and they have different geographic distributions. And these are dimorphic fungi. So in the environment, they exist in a mold phase, and then at higher temperatures inside the human, they convert to a yeast phase, which is pathogenic. In terms of clinical presentation, most of sporotrichosis is cutaneous disease, and around three quarters present with a lymphocutaneous form, and about the other quarter present with a fixed cutaneous form. So this is the lymphocutaneous form. So this was a patient from Brazil. So starting with the infection here on the hand, inoculation here, the lesions spread proximally along the lymphatic channels up to as high as almost the shoulder. And that's referred to as a sporotrichoid pattern or distribution of lesions. It's another patient with a lymphocutaneous form, the initial lesion here, and then lesions spreading proximally down the lymphatic channels. And then this is the fixed cutaneous form. So this is where infection is just localized to the site of inoculation. So you have a single lesion or maybe a plaque like this with some satellite lesions, but it's localized just to the area of initial infection. There are also some systemic presentations of sporotrichosis, and this usually occurs in immunosuppressed patients. And here you might have widespread skin involvement, bone and joint involvement, and even some ocular presentations. The diagnosis for sporotrichosis really relies on culture because you're unlikely to see the yeasts on direct microscopy. So if you culture clinical material at low temperature, you will get a growth in the mold form. If you then take a little piece of this and regrow it at a higher temperature, the organism will convert to its yeast phase, and it looks something like this. And there on microscopy, you can see these sort of oval-shaped yeasts. Okay, and then chromoblastomycosis. This is caused by various species of pigmented fungi, usually Fonsecaea and Cladophyllophora are the most common. And the diagnosis here is made on microscopy or on a biopsy when you observe these muriform cells or sclerotic bodies, as they're sometimes called. They're thick-walled pigmented structures that you see in the host. The presentation is typically with a verrucous or thickened plaque, and there's a range of presentations and severity. So ranging from on the left here, you can see quite localized disease, ranging going through to the right here to more extensive and verrucous presentations. And this is a very slowly progressive condition over years, and it really localizes just the skin and subcutaneous tissue. Dissemination beyond that is incredibly rare. But there are complications of this infection. So on the left here, you have lymphedema. Here you have facial lymphedema and scarring. Here you have contracture and deformity of a joint. And after many years, you can develop squamous cell carcinoma at the site of the infection. And that's what these bottom pictures are showing. So to make the diagnosis here, a skin scraping may be sufficient. And you may see the muriform cells from a scraping. Otherwise, if you take a skin biopsy, you can also see these cells. You can also, on a scraping, sometimes see pigmented hyphae, which you can see here. Okay, so now looking at how these infections are treated, there is some overlap here. So for mycetoma, firstly, if you're dealing with actinomycetoma, the bacterial form, then the cure rate is up to 90% with combinations of antibiotics. That's usually cotrimoxazole. Plus another, so sometimes that's amikacin, or it could be rifampicin or coamoxiclav. For the fungal form, the eumycetoma, the cure rate is nowhere near as good. It's probably more like 30 to 40%, and recurrence is high. And the treatment here is uses a combination of antifungals and surgery. So for small lesions, sometimes you would begin with surgery and excise the lesion and then treat with antifungals. But for most mycetomas, eumycetomas, you treat initially with antifungal therapy, then excise the lesion, and then continue antifungal therapy. And this is a nice example of function-preserving surgery. So you can see quite a radical excision of this mycetoma here, but at the same time preserving the tendon and the movement of the joint. Unfortunately, though, sometimes the surgery requires amputation. For sporotrichosis, the first line treatment is itraconazole at a starting dose of 1 to 200 milligrams per day. Terbinafine is a second line treatment. It also is effective in many cases. And another treatment that's often used is potassium iodide, and that's sometimes easier to access. And there are also surgical approaches. So for resistant lesions, especially if they're cystic lesions, you can excise them. And some centers use dermatherapy or cryotherapy, often in addition to antifungals to treat. So this is an example of fixed cutaneous sporotrichosis being treated with cryotherapy. So the more resistant area there. Okay, and then for chromoblastic mycosis, again, first line is itraconazole. Terbinafine is often used, and the response rate varies quite widely from sort of 15% up to 85%, probably depending on the species that's causing the infection. But there are other options such as posaconazole. And again, you have surgical and physical therapies that can be helpful, especially as adjuncts. Okay, so finally, looking at the link with flooding. So there is an increased risk of deep fungal infections in flooding situations, but also in other natural disasters. And this is, as Sidra mentioned, there is disruption to the environment, and environmental pathogens are pushed into areas where they wouldn't perhaps normally be. And there is an increased risk of trauma, including skin trauma, which may serve as a route of infection for these conditions. Because these are slowly progressive infections, you're typically looking at months to years after injury, after trauma, and after the disaster before these conditions might present. But with climate change, with increased risk of these events happening, and also population growth, this might be something that we see more often in the future. So this is a case of the mycetoma. So as you can see, the patient sustained an injury to the scalp in 1983 during a storm, had years of repeated treatment to the skin in the community, and then in 2007, in a dermatology department, was diagnosed with actinomycetoma. But at this time, he'd also developed headaches, and MRI scans showed infiltration of the or epidural infiltration, and actually a mass in the occipital lobe. And at the time that case was published, the patient was still alive and being treated. He'd had surgery and ongoing antibiotic treatment, but you can imagine the prognosis is not good in that case. Sporotrichosis, we know that there is some evidence that cases occur more often in months with higher rainfall. There's some data, a small number of patients from Australia showing that. And there have been outbreaks associated with flooding in China. So more than 400 cases in the early 90s. And then with flooding of River Nen in 1998, there were, again, over 200 cases, which all presented around 3 to 6 months after the flooding along that river. And just finally, there are some other infections which aren't typically classed as deep fungal infections, but they do cause deep subcutaneous infections. So one of them is mucormycosis. This has been seen in survivors of the tsunami in Sri Lanka. Usually this is in the context of polymicrobial infection, and mucormycosis can progress to necrotizing fasciitis with a high mortality. And that's also been seen with other natural disasters, so volcano eruptions and tornadoes. And again, with the tsunami, there were reports from Thailand of polymicrobial infection of wounds, including with organisms such as Cladophyllophora bantiana, which normally causes infection in immunosuppressed patients, but here causing wound contamination, and also infection with fusarium, which in one case progressed to systemic infection. And there's a wide variation in the time of onset. So these infections may occur weeks after the trauma, as in this case here, or they may present several years, 10 or 20 years later.